Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD physician. Today we'll be discussing on one of the very another interesting topic, which mainly belongs to respiratory system, but also it is a part and parcel of cardiovascular system. So we are going to talk regarding pulmonary edema. Now you know that edema means collection of a fluid in an extracellular compartment. So when it is collected in and outside the alveoli, inside the lung parenchyma, we'll call that as pulmonary edema. So by definition, pulmonary edema is a condition which is characterized by fluid accumulation in lung due to extravasation of fluid from pulmonary vasculature into interstitium and alveoli. So basically it is inside the alveoli and surrounding the alveoli. That is what we call the interstitium. That we call as a pulmonary edema. Now it is divided into two big groups, cardiogenic, non-cardiogenic. So cardiogenic means it is because of basic etiology is cardiovascular system. And again in cardiovascular system, it is left ventricular failure, which may be acute or may be chronic. But in a case of a non-cardiogenic, there are many conditions which can produce pulmonary edema. We'll be going through those particular groups separately. So if you divide into non-cardiogenic and cardiogenic, now there are some criteria which are being laid down. So whenever there is a collection of fluid in and around alveoli, we call that as a pulmonary edema. And secondary to this pulmonary edema, there is interference with the gas exchange which will produce hypoxia. Due to increased workload, the person will start complaining of dyspnea. In a cardiogenic variety, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, or we call pulmonary venous pressure, will be more than 18. Now this pressure will be also elevated in left atrium, pulmonary vein, and when it is elevated in that, we call it a cardiogenic, or we also use the word congestive heart failure. And if the pressure in the left atrium or pulmonary vein, or we call pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, if it is less than 18, then it is put into a separate group we call as a non-cardiogenic. This non-cardiogenic can be because of increased permeability of capillary blood vessels of pulmonary circulation, and which is a classical example is ARDS, or maybe because of decreased plasma protein leading to decreased oncotic pressure. And because of decreased oncotic pressure, there is a collection of a fluid in a alveoli, in and around alveoli, or maybe because of a neurogenic cause, maybe because of negative pressure, we call re-expansion pulmonary edema, or maybe also because of inflammation. In some condition, it can be a mixed variety where there is a increased hydrostatic pressure plus increased permeability. So those group will be there in a non-cardiogenic group. Based on the underlying condition, we divide into two big groups, cardiogenic, non-cardiogenic. We already given one example that in a non-cardiogenic, it can be neurogenic, high altitude, pulmonary edema, short form it is called HAPE. In a post-aspiration pulmonary edema, re-expansion pulmonary edema, maybe because of toxins, maybe because of lymphatic obstruction, post-lung transplant, etc. In cardiogenic, there is only one etiology we call as a congestive heart failure or a left ventricular failure. While in a non-cardiogenic variety, it can be because of ARDS. We'll be discussing separately ARDS in detail. And that can be because of direct lung injury or indirect lung injury. Or there can be injury to the lung because of neurogenic pulmonary edema, high altitude pulmonary edema, we call it the HAPE, re-expansion pulmonary edema, reperfusion pulmonary edema, post-obstructive pulmonary edema, short form it is called POP. It may be because of drugs, or maybe because of toxins, or maybe because of inhalant, or maybe because of inflammation, etc. That is put into a separate group called as a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, that is NCPE. So ARDS comes topmost on the list. There is another group called as a hypoproteinemia or decreased oncotic pressure, post-lung transplant, lymphatic obstructions can also produce. We don't go into detail regarding a left ventricular failure etiology. Most common is acute MI and severe sudden shoot up of blood pressure, acute aortic regurgitation and acute MR. That acute AR and acute MR can be because of infective endocarditis, maybe because of traumatic damage or acute MI. Also, once in a while, in case of a myocarditis, dilated cardiomyopathy, it can end up with acute left ventricular failure. In cardiogenic, we already mentioned the precipitating factor in a separate chapter we call as a congestive heart failure. Those precipitating factor can be acute MI, non-compliance to particularly increased intake of salt, NSAID, steroids, then person who is not taking regularly medicines, severe anemia, sepsis, thyrotoxicosis, myocarditis, toxins like alcohol, cocaine, then chemotherapeutic agents like doxorubicin, or chronic valvular heart disease like aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation, etc. Also, it can be precipitated by sudden cardiac arrhythmia, particularly tachyarrhythmias like atrial flutter fibrillation, ventricular tachycardias, uncontrolled hypertension, hypertensive crisis, fluid overload, acute respiratory infections, or inappropriate use of inotropes, NSAID, etc. As far as a post-obstructive pulmonary edema is concerned, they are divided into two groups, type 1 and type 2. In type 2, it is usually following a post-tonsillectomy or removal of upper airway tumors or hypertrophic valve, uvula. So when that is removed, suddenly the obstruction is removed and person can develop acute pulmonary edema. While in a type 1 variety, it is usually following extubation, following done for laryngospasm, or you have done some treatment for epiglottitis, croup, or foreign body, after removal of foreign body, strangulation, hanging, endotracheal tube obstruction, laryngeal tumors, goiter, etc. When you treat those particular condition, you can get post-obstructive pulmonary edema. As far as the drug induced is concerned, most common is narcotic overdose, opiums, and chemotherapeutic agents. Very rarely in case of salicylates and calcium antagonist overdose. Even hydrochlorothiazide overdose also it can produce, but rare. Radio contrast media can produce fulminant pulmonary edema again, but it is rare. Now, if you go through a pathophysiology, there is a one simple slide which I will show you. Yes, heading wise, it can be imbalance between stalling forces, that is increased hydrostatic pressure, or because of increase in venous pressure or decrease in oncotic pressure, or increase in negative interstitial pressure, or maybe because of even inflammation producing damage to capillary network. In case of ARDS, it is a damage to alveolar capillary membrane, leading to increased permeability. It can also be secondary due to lymphatic obstruction. So these are all, or sometimes we cannot identify, we call it the idiopathic. This is a very simple diagram showing you if the person hydrostatic pressure is normal, oncotic pressure is normal, there is no exudation of fluid. Now, if there is an increase in hydrostatic pressure, like in congestive heart failure, mitral stenosis, mitral regurgitation, acute MI, etc., which leads to congestive heart failure or acute left ventricular failure. Second name for rapid onset of acute left ventricular failure is also called as a flash heart failure. And if there is a decreased oncotic pressure, classical example, nephrotic syndrome, severe liver disease like cirrhosis of liver or end-stage liver disease, or maybe even because of malnutrition like Kwashiorkor marasmus, or maybe also in case of what we call as a GI tract malabsorption syndrome, protein losing enteropathy, etc. In both this condition, suppose if there is an increase in hydrostatic pressure, it will lead to fluid filtration from arterial side. And if there is a decreased oncotic pressure, then there will be a fluid filtration because of difference between hydrostatic and oncotic pressure becomes more, and there will be extra fluid filtration. So even if the hydrostatic pressure is normal and if the oncotic pressure is low, there will be transudation of fluid. So in these two conditions, that is increased hydrostatic pressure or decreased oncotic pressure, there is transudate which will be filtered out in alveoli. But in case of microvascular injury like ARDS, infection, aspiration pneumonias, or drug induced, or radiotherapy toxication, chemotherapeutic drugs, etc., it will be a mixed because of damage to capillary network, and that will produce exudate variety of infiltration, exudate variety of filtration into alveoli. In a case of a high altitude pulmonary edema, re-expansion pulmonary edema, which is because of sudden decrease in negative pressure, or maybe because of neurogenic variety, or because of injury to the microvascular blood vessels, will lead to fluid exudation, where you can have water plus other materials. So we'll be going through that in further detail as we pass through. So basically, there are different types of pathophysiology in different diseases. In a case of a congestive heart failure and hypoproteinemia, you will have a pure transudate, while in case of non-cardiogenic variety, where there is a damage to capillary permeability, as for example, in case of a ARDS, there will be increased exudation of fluid plus protein, and there's a diffuse alveolar damage leading to increased hydrostatic pressure as well as increased permeability. So because of increased permeability, there will be exudation of exudate type of material into alveoli, which will be rich in protein as well as cellular material. So this will be the basic mechanism which will be taking place. This is the pathophysiology which we have already explained in a congestive heart failure chapter. That is left ventricular failure, how it ends up. That in a left ventricular failure, because left ventricle is not able to eject the blood into aorta, there is an excessive blood in a left ventricle which will increase left ventricular and diastolic pressure, which will increase left atrial pressure, which will increase pulmonary venous pressure, and secondary to increase in pulmonary venous pressure, there is pulmonary edema that will produce pulmonary hypertension, and then finally it will end up with a congestive cardiac failure. So because of increased left atrial pressure, there is an increased pulmonary venous pressure, and secondary to increased pulmonary venous pressure, there is a pulmonary edema. And secondary to pulmonary edema, now person will complain of orthopnea, cough, blood stain, frothy sputum, There will be central cyanosis due to severe hypoxia, because hemoglobin cannot be oxygenated. So we will have an excess of deoxyhemoglobin circulating in a systemic circulation. And secondary to increase in right ventricular pressure, pulmonary hypertension, right ventricular pressure will be elevated, right atrial pressure will be elevated, and person will now develop symptom signs of congestive heart failure. And that is what is going to happen in a what we call as a cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So this is that diagram which is showing you in short. Left ventricular failure, left ventricle and diastolic pressure will be elevated, left atrial pressure will be elevated, pulmonary wedge pressure will be elevated, arterial pressure will be elevated, pulmonary edema will set in, pulmonary hypertension, hypoxia, central cyanosis, right ventricular pressure elevation, right atrial pressure elevation, and congestive cardiac failure. In this, there are three stages what they divide. In stage 1, all excess of fluid can be cleared by lymphatic drainage. Stage 2 is characterized by presence of interstitial edema. Stage 3 characterized by alveolar edema due to altered alveolar capillary permeability. So these are the three different stages which you can come across. So stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. This you can see in a case of a pulmonary edema stages. Depending upon the severity of pulmonary edema, it is divided into mild, moderate and severe. In case of a mild variety, there is an engorgement of a pulmonary vasculature. In moderate variety, there is an exudation of fluid, extravasation of fluid into interstitial place due to change in oncotic pressure. And stage 3 is called severe alveolar filling will take place. Now, in a variety of HAP, there is an altered permeability in an alveolar capillary membrane, which will lead to increased pulmonary vasoconstriction and high capillary pressure. And secondary to that, it will induce endothelial leakage and there will be fluid collection in an interstitial and alveolar edema without diffuse alveolar damage. While in case of ARDS, there is a diffuse alveolar damage. And this will produce dyspnea at rest, cough with frothy sputum, and there will be neurological disturbance associated with brain edema. So that is classical in case of a HAP. We call it a high altitude pulmonary edema. So typical picture of pulmonary edema will be present with altered level of consciousness together will be very commonly seen in HAP. In a neurogenic pulmonary edema, it is characterized by acute onset of pulmonary edema due to damage to central nervous system, which can be spinal cord injury, subarachnoid hemorrhage, traumatic brain injury, intracranial hemorrhage, status epilepticus, subdural hemorrhage, or we call subdural hematoma, meningitis, etc. In all this, because of catecholamine, which will produce cardiopulmonary dysfunction. And this is a variety which you will come across because of acute insult to central nervous system. So in a neurogenic pulmonary edema, exact cause of that is still unknown, but it is believed to be because of increased capillary hydrostatic pressure. That is because of increased secretion of catecholamines, and that will produce increased capillary permeability. Secondary due to head injury, intracranial hemorrhage, subarachnoid hemorrhage, meningitis, etc. All these mechanisms. And that will produce exudation of fluid, which will be high protein content. Secondary due to increased capillary leakage. So that is typical in a case of a neurogenic pulmonary edema. You should be, if a person has got basal cracks and there are ECG changes showing you and severe ischemia in presence of acute insult to CNS, do suspect neurogenic pulmonary edema. This is a detailed mechanism given in a subarachnoid hemorrhage. There's a raised intracranial pressure. because of raised intracranial pressure, maybe subarachnoid hemorrhage, or maybe subdural hematoma, maybe meningitis, maybe head injury, intracranial hemorrhage, maybe because of any other etiology. There is sympathetic activation. Because of sympathetic activation, one, directly it will increase your capillary permeability. There will be pulmonary vasoconstriction, which will increase your pulmonary venous pressure. That will increase your pulmonary capillary pressure and increases pulmonary capillary permeability. Or because of systemic vasoconstriction, systolic blood pressure will be elevated. Left ventricular compliance will be decreased. Left atrial pressure will be elevated. That will give rise to pulmonary capillary pressure elevation and increased capillary permeability, which will finally end up with neurogenic pulmonary edema. Also, there will be increased pulmonary blood volume because of increased pulmonary circulation. All this will end up with what we call as a neurogenic pulmonary edema. Same mechanism almost indirectly holds true because of increased intracranial pressure and increased sympathetic activity because of release of catecholamines. In a re-expansion pulmonary edema, because of removal of external pressure surrounding the lung tissue, that will produce expansion of the lung. Because of sudden expansion of the lung, this particular lung will have a negative pressure inside the lung, which will suck the blood into the lung. There will be increased perfusion and will develop rapid fluid shift from systemic into pulmonary circulation, and that will produce pulmonary edema. So because of change in the pressure inside the lung, there is pulmonary edema, and this will be very common in treatment in tension pneumothorax. So ideally, the air should be removed gradually, not very fast. That will result into what we call as re-expansion pulmonary edema. Also, there is one word called as a re-expansion or post-obstructive pulmonary edema, where as soon as you remove the obstruction, either at the level of larynx or at the higher level, say in the nasal cavity or in the oral cavity, there is sudden expansion of the lung, and because of sudden expansion of the lung, there was a high pressure outside the lung, and because of sudden expansion, there is a high negative pressure, and that will produce shift of fluid from systemic circulation into pulmonary circulation, and that will give rise to what we call as exudation of fluid. So that is also called as negative pressure pulmonary edema. So this is what is going to happen in that particular condition. There is one another condition called as a near drowning pulmonary edema. It is because of result of inhalation of either a fresh water or a sea water. And because of that, you get fluid collection in an alveoli. And that can be divided into stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3. We don't go into detail regarding that. In stage 1, there is a laryngospasm after inhalation of small amount of water. In stage 2, there is a laryngospasm but may begin to swallow water into stomach. And in stage 3, 85 to 90% of the patient, laryngospasm now relaxes. There is a secondary hypoxia and large amount of water will now be aspirated again into what we call as a tracheobronchial tree, leading to pulmonary edema, and again there will be persistent of in 10 to 15% with laryngospasm. So this will be there. In this variety, in where the laryngospasm is relieved, you will have aspiration of fluid into the tracheobronchial tree. While in case of a severe laryngospasm, you will have nearly what we use the word dry drowning. There is another condition like eclampsia. Again, in this also, you can have a massive sympathetic discharge, which can produce hypervolemia, hypoalbuminemia, or because of DIC may play a role as far as pulmonary edema is concerned. While in a cardioversion, following a cardioversion, because secondary due to tachyarrhythmias, there is some neurological mechanism, neurogenic mechanism may be playing a role. And that will release a lot of catecholamines, and that can end up with pulmonary edema. Also, during post-anesthesia also, it may be one of the mechanisms where person can get pulmonary edema, either because of sudden relief of post-obstruction because of laryngospasm during anesthesia, or because of increased excessive secretion of catecholamines, etc., or maybe because of fluid overload. There are a lot of different mechanisms. Post-cardiopulmonary bypass, I'm skipping over all this. Any person who gets a pulmonary edema, maybe because of cardiogenic or maybe because of non-cardiogenic. Dyspnea on exertion, particularly in a cardiogenic variety, dyspnea on exertion, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, orthopnea, classical findings. Person will have a productive cough, blood-stained froth is put up, bronchospasm producing wheezing, and there were basal crackles. Because of hypoxia, person will have tachypnea and tachycardia. Also, there will be labored breathing. Accessory muscle of respiration will be working. Person will have a confusion, agitation. Person might may be hypertensive. There will be cold, clammy extremities. Central cyanosis with peripheral cyanosis, we call it the mixed cyanosis. P2 will be loud. There will be S3 gallop. Heart sounds will be little feeble. JVP will be elevated. You will also have peripheral edema, hepatosplenomegaly, ascites, etc. So you can have an acute onset or a long-term symptoms. Whenever you see any person of pulmonary edema, you will have to approach. We have already done in a separate chapter called as approach to congestive heart failure. So a good history, good cardiovascular and respiratory examination will help you to differentiate between cardiogenic and non-cardiogenic variety. So there are some findings which will help you. S3 gallop will be more common with cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. And LV dysfunction will be more common with cardiogenic than non-cardiogenic. Murmurs will be very commonly seen in a cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. Central venous pressure will be also elevated much more, and you will have all the signs of volume overload, peripheral edema, hepatosplenomegaly, etc. will be much more common in cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. So always look for those particular conditions. In abdominal examination, always look for what we call as acute lung injury, which will be more common with non-cardiogenic edema. So, very simple difference. S3 gallop, elevated JVP, peripheral edema, basal crackles, blood-stained frothy sputum, orthopnea, exertional dyspnea, cardiomegaly, presence of murmur, past history of ischemic heart disease, etc. will be all in favor of cardiogenic. While pulmonary finding relatively normal in early stages, and later on you get a mild dyspnea to a respiratory failure with chest x-ray showing your diffuse alveolar infiltrate, more peripheral rather than central, and SpO2, FiO2 level markedly reduce, will go more in favor of non-cardiogenic rather than cardiogenic. One simple test which will help you to differentiate very easily is a left atrial pressure or pulmonary venous pressure or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. If it is more than 18, it is straightforward in favor of cardiogenic. If it is less than 18, it is more in favor of non-cardiogenic. That is what we call as a ventilation perfusion mismatch. If a person gets a response to oxygen therapy very nicely, you give a good oxygen, person responds much better. It is more in favor of cardiogenic. But if in spite of giving oxygen, still hypoxia persists, it will be more in favor of what we call as a non-cardiogenic, classical example ARDS. On a plain X-ray, if you see a cardiomegaly with curly A line, curly B line, you get pulmonary congestion, bat wing appearance, or we call butterfly appearance, kyphalization of a pulmonary vasculature, presence of bilateral pleural effusion goes more in favor of cardiogenic, while normal heart size, almost we say that the bronchovascular marking not much prominent, pleural effusion is almost very rarely seen, and there is a peripheral alveolar infiltration, bilateral, goes more in favor of non-cardiogenic. And these are all those particular features what are being shown here. Heart size, vascular distribution, pleural effusion, curly A line, curly B line, which will be present more in cardiogenic. They are not present in case of non-cardiogenic. At your leisure time, you can go through. Same what difference we have mentioned before. This is cardiovascular finding, S3 gallop, JVP elevated, peripheral edema, basal crackles, central cyanosis with peripheral cyanosis, or we call mixed cyanosis, cold clammy extremities, etc. More goes in favor of cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. So this, all this difference we already mentioned, same thing is given here. At your leisure time, you can go through. This is a very good charts which are being mentioned. This is also a good. You can go through here at leisure time. And this is what you ideally require to differentiate between cardiogenic and non-cardiogenic. As far as investigation is concerned, X-ray chest is very useful. We already mentioned X-ray chest finding. CT and MRI is not of much use, but it is helpful to differentiate different etiology producing pulmonary edema. ABG and serum electrolytes will be helpful to find out the severity of hypoxia, hypercapnia, and acid-base imbalance. EKG in case of cardiogenic will show you ischemic heart disease, ventricular hypertrophy, cardiac arrhythmias, tachyarrhythmias, etc. While in case of a non-cardiogenic, usually we don't come across ischemic heart disease. Ventricular hypertrophy is not commonly seen in a ECG in case of a ARDS. Echocardiography will be very, very helpful in a cardiogenic variety rather than a non-cardiogenic variety. Right heart and left heart catheterization is also very helpful to differentiate between cardiogenic and non-cardiogenic. While doing a right heart catheterization, if a pulmonary pressure is close to normal and if in a pulmonary wedge pressure, or we call pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, if it is more than 18, it is more in favor of cardiogenic. Less than 18 is more in favor of a non-cardiogenic variety. BNP and pro-BNP will be more elevated and more abnormal in case of a cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. Pulmonary function test will be not of much help, but to rule out a cor pulmonale, which is a close differential diagnosis in these groups. Pulmonary function test will help to rule out obstructive from a non-obstructive variety. Serum amylase and lipase will help to rule out ARDS secondary due to pancreatitis, acute pancreatitis, which is one of the very common cause for non-pulmonary causes or extra-pulmonary causes for ARDS. So ECG in case of a cardiogenic variety will show tachyarrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias, acute MI, ventricular hypertrophy, etc. We have already shown you that on an X-ray, if you see curly B line, it is more sensitive. Ultrasonography will give you an idea regarding the left ventricular end diastolic pressure, left ventricular volume, left atrial pressure, left atrial dilatation, presence of thrombus, embolism, infective endocarditis, valvular heart disease, cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, restrictive pericardial disease. All these conditions can be easily ruled out on ultrasonography. We have already told you in a chest X-ray, if you see heart size being enlarged, curly A line, curly B line, bilateral pleural effusion, also presence of cephalization of a pulmonary vasculature, etc., goes more in favor of a cardiac rather than non-cardiac. There is one particular word which is being utilized is ABCD. A for alveolar edema, which can be seen in the form of a pulmonary plethora, bat wing appearance, or we call butterfly appearance, curly B lines, cardiomegaly, dilated upper lobe vessels, and pleural effusion. This is one mnemonic which is being described, ABCD. You can remember whichever way you want. In good number of condition, you can get hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, that is more common with cardiogenic. Severe anemia is also more common with cardiogenic, which can be precipitating factor. In a pulse oximeter, you will get hypoxia, tachycardia. In ABG, you will get a hypoxic hypocapnia or hypoxic hypercapnia. That will be there. When there is an hypocapnia, it will produce respiratory alkalosis. And if there is a hypercapnia, it will produce respiratory and metabolic acidosis. Both will be together. And that is quite common in a person with ARDS. We already mentioned in an echocardiography, you will be able to differentiate papillary muscle dysfunction, acute VSDA, cardiac tamponade, acute MR, acute AR, etc. can be easily differentiated. Pulmonary, or we call right side catheterization, will help you to differentiate between cardiac and non-cardiac. If pulmonary capillary wedge pressure is more than 18, it is straightforward cardiogenic. Less than 18, non-cardiogenic. These are all the investigations we have already told you regarding a BNP. BNP and pro-BNP, if they are markedly elevated, they are more in favor of a cardiogenic rather than non-cardiogenic. So that will also give you a good idea. This I'm skipping over. This is bat wing appearance. This is neurogenic pulmonary edema. This is also one variety of a pulmonary edema. That is at a HAP, we call high altitude pulmonary edema. This is improvement after giving oxygen, etc. This is showing you curly B lines, which are very prominent at base. Echocardiography findings, you can go for a transesophageal also, transthoracic or transesophageal. Pulmonary arterial catheterization, etc. And you should differentiate between cardiogenic and non-cardiogenic. And if it is non-cardiogenic, from a history, you can easily identify neurogenic, decompression, or we call re-expansion, post-obstructive, or HAP, etc. You can easily differentiate from a good history. As far as management is concerned, cardiogenic pulmonary edema, we have already discussed in a chapter of what we call as an approach to congestive heart failure, where person will acquire an orthopneic posture, good amount of oxygen, diuretic, ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, nitrates, inotropic drugs, and phlebotomy becomes a prime choice. So these are all the different choices which you can have. That is emergency treatment, that is oxygen, orthopneic posture, positive pressure ventilation. You can reduce the preload and increase the force of contraction, that is inotropic supports, by giving diuretic, nitroglycerin, morphine, etc. Increase the compliance by reducing infection, treating renal failure, treating anemia. You can use Lasix, morphine, nitrates, oxygen, position. These are all the different treatments we have already discussed previously. You can use BiPAP, CPAP. These are all for cardiogenic pulmonary edema. These are all those drugs which you can use for cardiogenic pulmonary edema, that is inotropes, diuretics, to decrease the afterload, preload, For preload, nitroglycerin and diuretics are the first drug of choice. For afterload, ACE inhibitor, diuretics like you can use diuretics. You can use nitroprusside. And for inotropic action, dobutamide, dopamine or noradrenaline. Or also you can use intra-aortic balloon pumps. That is we call assisted device. All those you can use. These are all different methods. Or you can go for CRT, cardiac resynchronization therapy. Or you can also go for ICT, intracardiac device. You can go for cardiogenic treatment like DC shock, reperfusion therapy, etc. Also non-invasive ventilation, positive pressure ventilations, extracorporeal ECMO you can utilize. In neurogenic, oxygen, diuretic and inotropics are the mainstay, and very rarely you require a surgical intervention for treatment of raised intracranial pressure, subdural hematoma, etc. This will be secondary. But first treatment will be oxygen, diuretics and inotropic supports. In case of HAPE, again oxygen, CCB like nifedipine, hydralazine and acetazolamide. These are the prime drugs. Sometimes they also utilize inhaled nitric oxide, nitrous oxide. So that will be the one of the treatment in case of HAPE. Re-expansion, always have a precaution that whenever you do a re-expansion, have a gradual re-expansion rather than a rapid. And you can use diuretics. And preload reductions are contraindicated because it will reduce your preload. And that is one of the contraindications in a case of a person where you are doing re-expansion pulmonary edema. Ideally, the person requires oxygen therapy as a support, and you should re-expand gradually. As far as complication is concerned, in any pulmonary edema, there is always possibility of severe hypoxia. Along with severe hypoxia, you can develop hypocapnia or hypercapnia. Initially, it is always hypocapnia. Later on, there is a hypercapnia. So, and that can end up with type 1 or type 2 failure. You can have an irreversible congestive cardiac failure or congestive heart failure. And that will be very common in a cardiogenic. Secondary due to shock stage, you can develop AKI. And some good number of time, if not diagnosed early and if not treated properly, in both variety, cardiogenic and non-cardiogenic variety, you can have high mortality and person can have even a death. So I end my lecture here. These are all the different complications which can be there, like edema, ascites, pleural effusion, hepatomegaly, myocardial infarction can produce, can be there, cardiogenic shock, arrhythmias, electrolyte imbalance, protein enteropathy, respiratory arrest, and person can die also. Prognosis depends upon how fast you diagnose and how carefully you give the treatment. So I end my lecture here. I hope this lecture will be very helpful to you, because once in a while you will come across a person with pulmonary edema, which is very, very common as far as cardiogenic is concerned. And as far as the non-cardiogenic is concerned, ARDS is the most common variety which you will come across in your everyday practice. And you should be able to differentiate between ARDS and cardiogenic variety, that is acute left ventricular failure, because in both the treatment is absolutely different. Prognosis is also very different. In ARDS, there's a good number of limitations to the modes of treatment. While in case of cardiogenic pulmonary edema, there are a lot of treatment which can give you a good results if diagnosed early and treated early. So I end my lecture here. I hope this will be very helpful to you. See you in the next lecture.